This new generation of consoles and graphics cards is all about ramping up gamers' resolutions and frame rates. But there's one feature that consumers are still not sold on, and that's ray tracing. Today, we're going to take AMD's top card and a couple of NVIDIA's latest GPUs to show you guys the sort of performance you should expect and shine some light on what ray tracing looks like in several different games. Hey guys, Turk here. I hope you're having a solid day. I have been a longtime supporter of ray tracing, though not fully shilling out like my Tom's Hardware brethren. As a tech enthusiast, seeing new technologies come to market and seeing them being adopted always gets my nerd juices flowing. However, ray tracing has come under a lot of scrutiny due to its rocky launch, lackluster adaptation, and unfortunately, heavy performance impact. Fortunately though, ray tracing is baked into all of the current generation offerings from AMD and NVIDIA, and developer support for the feature is increasing, along with other technologies that leverage the GPU's growing strengths. But let's take a step back. What is ray tracing? If you've watched any recent movies with lots of CGI, such as Endgame or any of the Transformer movies, the chances are good that you have witnessed the technique in action. Essentially, ray tracing is a technique to estimate realistic lighting in a scene by casting rays from potential light sources and estimating how those rays interact with surfaces, ultimately bouncing into your eyeballs. This is a great cinematic approach with movies and can be rendered in near perfect detail through specialized render servers. But that's the catch. The renders take several days, if not weeks, to complete. Lucky for us, we aren't aiming for movie quality, and we don't exactly need 100% accuracy in our gameplay. So on the desktop, our GPUs can leverage their parallelism and their custom hardware to speed up the process. By doing so, developers can leverage real-time ray tracing in order to add an extra layer of immersion into our gameplay. If you're looking for more detail regarding the nuts and bolts of the ray tracing process, I highly recommend the Digital Foundry video, I'll put a link up at the top, where they discuss the steps and render time impacts for a few of the different technologies. Now that we have a base level of knowledge of the technology, let's talk about how the tech is implemented. At the low level, APIs are written to engage the video driver and leverage the hardware's potential. I'll be looking at today's big APIs, DirectX 12 and Vulkan, though other companies are making their own special sauce. Going up another level, several engines utilize these programming libraries to implement ray tracing into games, which include, but not limited to, Frostbite, Unreal Engine, Unity, and the Red Engine. We aren't going to be digging into each of these engines today, but know that at that level, developers are in charge of what ray tracing features they want to use, how heavily they want to integrate them, and what sort of options they want to let the gamer tweak for their own preferences. Now, this is what makes testing and communicating ray tracing very challenging. On the one hand, RTX branding has made it straightforward to say, yeah, this game's got ray tracing, but there are many techniques within ray tracing. Ray trace shadows improve shadow accuracy, global illumination improves how light interacts with materials and impacts dynamic lighting, ray traced reflections accurately depict reflections based on the material, the lighting, and the viewing angle, and the holy grail of ray tracing, full path tracing, encapsulates almost all of these techniques for a completely ray traced scene. However, the more complex the technique, the heavier the performance cost. Couple that with traditional game rendering methods such as screen space reflections, they've gotten just so good, people often ask, what's the point? Another huge criticism that people throw shade at ray tracing is the number of games that support the feature. Now, I'll admit, the number of games is limited. I've counted about 27 currently released games with some variant of ray tracing. However, there are quite a few heavy hitters in this lineup. We got Fortnite, Call of Duty, Cyberpunk, Minecraft, World of Warcraft, and there's several slower paced action games that they're not irrelevant to the market. Sure, some of the lesser known titles have a few thousand concurrent players on them at any given day, but some of those big guns, they've got players ranging in the hundreds of thousands of players. That is a lot of potential gamers that could benefit from the increased immersion from ray tracing. And with consoles beginning to shine a bit of light on the tech's potential with Spider-Man, Watch Dogs Legion, and there's plenty of others on the way, developers likely won't waste their resources on implementing the gimmick for one audience and not let others use it. As long as they can control the level of ray tracing to implement, they can control how the game looks, feels, and performs. Regardless, the software is only as good as the hardware it runs on, so let's take a look at the types of GPUs on the market. NVIDIA has a bit of experience with ray tracing hardware from their RTX 2000 series GPUs. Their latest 3000 series GPUs boast an improved performance of their dedicated ray tracing and tensor cores. Architecturally, each streaming multiprocessor of the GPU contains one RT core and four tensor cores, so plenty of dedicated hardware on NVIDIA's cards, right? For AMD, things are a bit different. Only their latest RX 6000 series cards can run the feature, with each compute unit containing one Ray accelerator unit. Now, I'm not going to get into the nitty-gritty, but for the top cards, it appears that AMD has more smaller cores and NVIDIA has fewer bigger cores. Now, that's definitely an oversimplification, but keep that in mind as we walk down each company's product stack. Today, I'm testing AMD's top dog with the 6900 XT and putting it side by side with an RTX 3080 and 3070. Ideally, I'd have a 6800 XT in this video as well, but we know how the market is these days. I'll put the rest of the system configuration down in the description below. While we talk through the different benchmarks, I want to show you guys the ray traced versus non-ray traced versions of the gameplay so you can kind of compare and contrast the different techniques that we're talking about. Let me know down in the comments if you can even spot the differences. Let's start off with some synthetics. 3DMark has developed several benchmarks for testing the latest tech, so let's take a look at their ray tracing benchmark. Here, static scenes are being rendered and ray traced using the GPU's compute shaders instead of the traditional rasterization pipeline. This forces the frame rate to be heavily reliant on ray tracing performance instead of other pipelines. By varying the number of sample rays per pixel, we can measure the ray tracing unit's impact on frame rates and frame times. As expected, with only two samples per pixel, we see a high level of performance from each of the cards. When we triple the sample size, our frame rate performance gets cut between 58 and 64%. The scaling continues as we increase the sample size, and for better or worse, the RTX cards show their dominance in this synthetic benchmark. But will this translate into real gameplay? Let's dive in with a complete implementation of ray tracing in Minecraft RTX. This game leverages every trick in the book regarding ray tracing, relying on Microsoft's DirectX 12 API and the RenderDragon engine. Here, every material and every pixel is fully ray traced, and man, it shows. This game is gorgeous. Despite the elementary textures and graphical design, the ray tracing technology cripples even the strongest of GPUs. Here, the AMD card only manages to run at 1080p, which means if you want to play Minecraft with that sweet ray tracing enabled, definitely go NVIDIA. However, Minecraft RTX is so demanding that at even 1440p, the best card is only able to sneak by with playable frame rates. 4K? Ha! I'm not Linus, I can't shill that hard. Similar story with the other poster child for full path tracing, Quake 2 RTX. Recent updates to the game now enable the Vulkan API, so we can test out AMD's hardware as well. Today, we're only going to be adjusting the global illumination setting. Taking a look at the chart, the 6900 XT is hammered with either of the global illumination presets at 1080p. Clearly, AMD struggles with heavy ray tracing, but scaling, it is still observed. The 3070 drops by 50% at each resolution, and even the 3080 is hammered. Clearly, full path tracing is impressive, but it's just not realistic in gameplay with today's hardware. Let's take a look at a more modern looking game. Metro Exodus leans on DirectX 12 for its global illumination. Even more ray tracing techniques come with their latest DLCs, and their soon to be released Enhanced Edition aims to update its entire graphic engine with ray tracing fully integrated into the mix. On the current version of the game, let's take a look at how each GPU performs. Surprisingly, all cards are playable up to 1440p with high ray tracing settings, The AMD car does take the larger percentage hit with a 39% performance penalty for that sweet, sweet ray tracing. Both NVIDIA cards only get reduced by 27%. The jump to 4K is less than ideal, with the RTX dropping by 34% and AMD reduced by 47%. If y'all want me to take a look at the Enhanced Edition, let me know down in the comments. And if you're looking for any other examples of global illumination in action, look no further than the Juggernaut, Fortnite. Shadow of the Tomb Raider's ray traced shadows is a bit more realistic for our hardware. On the one hand, AMD's GPU takes the top spot with raw rasterization, but that win is irrelevant in this discussion. With ultra ray trace shadows enabled, ray tracing induces a massive 46% reduction in frame rate. However, even at 1440p, AMD still shows above 60fps with healthy margins, suggesting that even the 6800 XT or 6800 can perform well with these types of games. Even at 4K, AMD puts up a fight, nearly matching the performance of the 3080. However, ray trace shadows is one of the least taxing types of ray tracing a developer can introduce. We see similarly limited implementations of this feature with Call of Duty and World of Warcraft. Control continues to reign as the go-to ray tracing monster. It utilizes DirectX 12 in its Northlight engine to integrate extensive use of ray traced reflections, diffuse light, and improved shadows along with dynamic debris. With all these features integrated, let's see if its performance is as bad as full path tracing. AMD can barely keep up at 1080p with a card that's less than half the cost. With the RTX 3070, its even stronger ray tracing performance is unfortunately overshadowed by a 50% performance hit. At 1440p, no card is playable at 60fps with ray tracing enabled. Even 4K can barely hit 30fps with the 3080. This game's ray tracing implementation is just so heavy, some sort of upscaling is required. Last, how about Cyberpunk? Oh yeah, CD Projekt Red has yet to enable ray tracing for AMD cards in their Red engine. However, I would suspect that performance would be similar to Control. That suggests that without using upscaling tech, regardless of the GPU, we are stuck ray tracing at 1080p. Now, let's pivot and try a different approach with Crytek's Neon Noir benchmark. Crytek leans on a hardware agnostic approach for its total illumination technology, allowing either hardware or software-based assets on our latest cards and focuses on a more sophisticated yet traditional approach. For software, it uses a DirectX 11 API, so in theory, any modern card can utilize these features, assuming it has the horsepower to run. So for an accurate comparison today, we're looking at the software-based ray tracing for all of the cards. Regardless, as we increase the resolution, each of the cards' performance today scales, and the AMD card does manage to keep pace with the RTX 3080, which might be promising for games that use this particular engine. Even if this approach is not using each company's specific RT hardware, this type of solution seems to be a great alternative for implementing ray tracing technology at a broader scale. Let's look at full software ray tracing in practice. Crysis Remastered showcases CryEngine in its full glory. Early versions, including what I used to collect today's data, simply enable the pure software-based ray tracing. With their 2.1 update, the engine will determine which method to use. Again, this video is only talking about the software implementation with Crysis. With Crysis Remastered, the AMD card takes the lead by a sizable margin and finally puts a win in AMD's column. Again, software-based ray tracing begins to cut a few corners using lower resolution reflections, reducing the types of surfaces that gain reflections, and reducing said reflections' polygon count. We can debate the quality of this type of ray tracing till the cows come home, but to say that AMD's hardware isn't up for the task is looking past what the data actually shows. So, sounds like AMD is garbage at ray tracing then, right? Well, there are some grounds for that argument, but I'd like to offer an alternative perspective. What frame rate is acceptable for gaming with ray tracing? If we're sticking to 1440p as our base resolution, Metro, Crysis Remastered, and Shadow of the Tomb Raider are playable at 60fps for all three cards today, with some margin to spare for the 6800 XT and potentially the 6800. In games that don't meet that threshold, we can at least hit 30 FPS. And when it comes to these thresholds, that's where the claim that AMD's ray tracing is garbage begins to fall apart. Outside of full path tracing, the 6900 XT manages to be competitive with the RTX 3080 within these thresholds. And if trends continue, the 6800 XT likely would only fall below these thresholds with Control or Cyberpunk. Of course, we can lower the levels of RT to gain back a bit of performance, but that could be said about any of the cards or games shown today. Regardless of the GPU, ray tracing is still very performance intensive, and let's not forget there is still plenty of room for improvement across the different APIs and engines. Red Gaming Tech continues to inform us that developers, they're finding new ways to program that improve AMD's ray tracing performance, so given a little bit of time, I'd imagine performance might get to just below the RTX 3080. And with RDNA 3, AMD's next generation GPU, will likely take many of the lessons learned and improve their ray tracing pipeline. Coupled with historical graphic horsepower improvements from either company, it wouldn't be unreasonable to see about 10 to 20% improvement in raw ray tracing performance in the coming generations. And as developers become more confident in balancing ray tracing quality versus the performance impact, we could see a lot of effects being more immersive without much of a performance hit. And I can already see the comments, "Turk, what about DLSS?" DLSS is a great way to mitigate the performance hit with ray tracing. Still, it would be unfair to do a pure ray tracing analysis when using another tech to compensate. AMD's Fidelity FX Super Resolution tech is slated for release sometime in 2021, but I'm not gonna hold my breath on if it's gonna be any good. If you guys would like me to cover DLSS, let me know over at Twitter. All right, guys, those are my thoughts on ray tracing with both AMD and Nvidia. Let me know what you think down in the comments. Did I miss anything? Are there any games you guys want me to check out and report back to you guys? I'm always looking to communicate and interact with you guys over on Discord, over on Twitch. Many different ways to get a hold of me and recommend videos or ask me questions. But again, thank you guys for watching the video. I hope y'all have a solid day. We'll catch you next week. Take care.